Good morning. Today, Cliff will be preaching on the kingdom of God and the scattering of seed. Sometimes I think we expect things to happen immediately in our Christian growth. We preach and witness, but the results are sometimes overwhelmingly ordinary. Children go to children's church and attend fusion and clash. An awkward teenager presents himself or herself for baptism. A young couple chooses to be married in the church. A men's group studies a popular Christian book. A women's group raises money to help a missionary on the other side of the world. It seems not to amount to much of anything, but the seed is growing. God is present. Watch out. Get on board. Will you stand and join us in our morning worship service as we begin in song, Get On Board.
Beside me. No wonder my heart is filled with joy and my mouth shouts his praise.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I I'll love you forever.
Oh Lord, we do come to you. We gather here in this place to worship you, but we're drawn by your love. We're drawn by your grace because we know we don't deserve it. None of us here do. But you are so good. And God, your grace reaches to the very depths of our lives. So no matter who we are and what we've done, we find acceptance through your sacrifice. And so we give great thanks. We sing these songs. We pray. We read your word. We do all of these things, God, so that we could know you better and be changed by you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please be seated. At this time, we invite the young people who would like to take advantage of the Children's Church program to be dismissed. For ages kindergarten through fourth grade, they have a special program, special church just for you upstairs, so you can make your way at this time to benefit from that special program. Track season is here, and local young people are competing in a variety of track and field events every week. The relay races are especially interesting because they demonstrate the principle that a team has greater ability than an individual alone. Four team members passing the baton as they run are faster than one individual running the same distance alone. The letters of the word team, T-E-A-M, remind us that together, everyone accomplishes more. To prepare for our prayer time, we need to consider what the Bible says about our ability to accomplish things alone by ourselves. I invite you to listen as I read a passage from Psalm 127, verse 1 and 2, which says, "Unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the guard stands watch in vain. In vain you rise early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat. But he grants sleep to those he loves." What can we learn from these words from Psalm 127? In this passage, the psalmist used several examples to point out what happens when we try to do things alone on our own power. Alone, the builder's efforts are in vain. Alone, the watchman's efforts are in vain. Alone, our labor and effort are all in vain. We need God in every area of our lives, in every situation. We need to pray to God with total and complete dependence upon him. We want to be a team with God, where he is already working, so that we can come alongside and work with him where he is already at work. We already have the joys and concerns and testimonies that were shared in our earlier worship service that we will include during our prayer time today. And we have some items that have been turned in by card as prayer joys and concerns, and other items that have been passed on verbally to the pastoral staff that we'll include. But we welcome the joys, concerns, and especially testimonies about what you would share about what you have seen and are seeing where God is at work. What would you share that we can include during our prayer time? We welcome your joys, concerns, and testimonies. Yes, back there. Thank you for that testimony about that, and we hope to have a good chance to discuss that more with the young people this Wednesday evening. So thank you very much. Other joys, concerns, yes? We'll pray for traveling mercies for Brooke. Other joys, concerns, and testimonies, we welcome the things that are on your heart. Yes. Yes, welcome, Carol. We're glad you're here. And if you haven't had a chance to see her and give her a hug, welcome her. Let her know that we're glad to have her. We're hoping to love on her and encourage her and interact with her in many ways in the days to come. So thank you, Carol. You bet. God bless you. Yes.
I'm just thankful that I got to spend time with my family celebrating my mom's 76th birthday.
Hey, that's great. Happy birthday to your mom, and great time of celebrating. That's neat. We're glad for that, and we rejoice with you. Thanks for sharing that. Other joys, concerns, and testimonies. We welcome the things that are on your heart. Yes, Phyllis. Okay, we'll pray for Sally Williams. She's trying to receive cancer treatments and had to postpone this last week, so we'll pray for her to be strong enough to have treatment again. I'm going to lead us in prayer in just a minute. I'm going to be following the... Is there a hand over here? Yes, okay. Okay, we'll pray for you on that. That's a lot of traveling, a lot of road miles between here and there, and we'll pray for you. I'm going to lead us in prayer in just a minute, and I see a hand back there. You bet. The rain was great, wasn't it? God's provision to help things grow. You bet. We're thankful for God's provision. Yeah. We'll pray for Jody's dad at Mitchell County Hospital. Thank you for sharing that. I'm going to lead us in prayer in just a minute with a pattern of prayer following the letters of the word pray, P-R-A-Y, in which P represents praise, R represents repent, A represents ask, and Y represents yield. I'm going to offer suggestions as I'm praying, but I want to encourage you to pray on your own in your own heart, however God prompts you. Let us pray. As I'm praying, I invite you to express your own praise and devotion to God in your own heart, however He prompts you. God, we do worship You. We acknowledge that You are the Creator, Sustainer, and Giver of all life. There's none other like You. You alone are holy, loving, and sovereign. You're almighty, eternal, and everlasting. The Scripture says, and we believe that the Lord God Almighty reigns. Praise God, praise God. As we move on in our prayers to a time to focus on repenting, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart, repenting in your own relationship with Him, however He prompts you. 1 John 1:9 reminds us that if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Thank you for that truth and for the hope that it offers. Because we know we can't pay the penalty of our own sin. The cost is too great. But the grace of God is enough. Jesus paid the penalty in full. So, God, we come to You and we repent. We confess our sins and we humbly ask for Your forgiveness, cleansing, and healing based on the shed blood of Jesus on the cross. As we move on in our prayers to a time of asking, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart, asking Him whatever He prompts you to ask. Psalm 127 reminds us, unless the Lord builds a house, the builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches a city, the guards stand watch in vain. In vain you rise early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat. For He grants sleep to those He loves. Thank You for that promise and that reminder that we can do nothing in our own ability, but we need to depend upon You in every way, each day, all the time. Lord, we praise You for this church family and the opportunity to share together on our spiritual journey. Help us, we pray, as we seek to encourage and lift one another up. Thank You for the many opportunities for growth and encouragement in the church family. We pray, along with Carol's focus, to remember Jody Files' dad as he's in the hospital, not doing well. Help him, we pray. We pray, along with Jennifer Bean, giving thanks for the rain that you send to water the earth and cause things to bring forth and sprout. We pray for Brenda Barron as she'll be traveling to Texas to help with arranging things that represent her dad's life and his memories. We pray that you give her safe travel and protection. We pray for Sally Williams as she's in the midst of treatment for cancer and wasn't able to have a treatment last week. We pray that you'd be with her, strengthen her, and help her to be able to receive the help that's needed. We give you praise along with Drew that he was able to share his mom's 76th birthday yesterday, and thank you for that celebration. We pray along with Vinette for Brooke as she's going to be traveling, protect and keep her, guide and direct her. We pray along with Karen and give praise for the Fusion young people and sponsors who were able to attend the Shack movie. We pray for opportunities to discuss that program and how it relates to our own spiritual journeys. We pray for Merlin Phobes as he recovers from skin cancer surgery last week. Help him, we pray. We pray along with Judy Stroop for her daughter, Jenny, as she has illness and needs your touch. We pray along with Becky Staley for her husband, Dan, as he'll be going to Wichita this week for eye procedure, and then to Hayes later in the week for a heart cath procedure. Help him, we pray. We pray along with Kelly Smith for Wanda Gripman as Wanda has started chemo treatments. Help her, we pray. We give you praise that Carol is with us, and we pray for Carol Tolbert to be able to have a good connection with many people and be encouraged as she is here for a period of time. We give you praise along with Heidi Sylvia for her decision last Sunday to join the church family on March 26th. We pray that you would help her as she seeks to follow you in her own faith and walk with you. We thank you for Rod Pearson's move to Hilltop Assisted Living, and we pray that you would help him to make that adjustment well. We pray and praise you for the Heart Choices Spring Banquet this next week on April 6th. We pray for many people to benefit from that program, to learn more about and to support Heart Choices. We pray for Dan Reeling's brother Dennis for his health concerns. Help him, we pray. We pray along with Tammy Eck for Cindy Cox for health concerns. And we pray for the youth pastor search team as they continue their process. Guide them, we pray, and help us as we continue as a church family to seek how to proceed on this opening we have. We want to remember the families of those who have experienced the passing of loved ones. We pray for the family of Dennis Shoemate, whose funeral was Friday. Send comfort and peace to his family. We pray for the family of Barbara Quakenbush, who passed away last week and whose memorial service will be Saturday, April 22nd. That's a ways off, but that's when it's going to work for their family to gather. We pray that you would be with them. Send comfort and peace. And for the family of Bernice Houghton, who passed away last week, send comfort and peace. And help us as a church family to know how we can have a part in reaching out to support and encourage those who have experienced the passing of loved ones. Be with Pastor Cliff as he shares your word. Fill him, anoint him, use him. Allow him to be a channel of your truth as he teaches from the Bible today. And we pray your spirit would be present to guide each one who hears, that we would sense your prompting and direction on how we can each personally apply your truth to each of our spiritual journeys. Help us, we pray. As we move on in our prayers to a time of yielding, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart, yielding to him however he prompts you. God, I yield to you and to you alone. John 15 reminds me that apart from you, I can do nothing. All my personal effort is worthless and empty without you. I would be like a builder who builds in vain without your help. I would be like a watchman who stays awake in vain without your help. So now I surrender totally and completely in every way to you, God, so you can work your will in and through me for your purpose and pleasure. God, I look forward to walking with you by faith each day every day. I pray all these things in the precious name of Jesus, my risen Lord and Savior. Amen.
Now is the time of our service when we have communion. We invite everyone who's accepted Christ as our Lord and Savior to participate in communion with us today. You don't have to be a member of our church to do so. We just ask that you would hold the bread and the cup until everyone is served, and we'll take communion together as a church family. Our scripture today is from Matthew 11, 28 to 30, which says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Recently, the last week, I went out to Colorado and visited my son and his family. And it was just a wonderful time. We didn't have a schedule very much, and I got to relax. And I felt pretty at peace with myself and the world. There wasn't anybody really having very many demands on my time. And I just got to lay back and enjoy myself. And then about 2 days ago, the thought came to me, I have to go back to work. And I thought, oh man, this is terrible. You know, so I started worrying about all the things that were going to be left for me to do when I got back. How many things had piled up that I was going to have to deal with. And pretty soon I got to thinking, you know, really, that's not, being out in Colorado is not what makes me happy, but really it's my relationship with Jesus. And I thought, you know, it's really not about my schedule, it's not about my circumstances, it's not about where I'm at, it's not about how much money I have in the bank, it's really all about Jesus. And in Philippians he says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." So that's really the answer to our worry and anxiety is Jesus. And if we spend time with him every day and share our problems with him so that he can be part of the solution, then we really can have a life where we're not worried and anxious, but we can really trust in him to take care of us. So that's the reason why we come and take communion today, is to celebrate Jesus doing that for us, that he was willing to die and pay the cost so that we could be attached to him, that we could go to him, and he could be our friend and our Savior. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for the fact that Jesus was willing to die for us. He was willing to give up his life so that he could be in fellowship with us. And we just are amazed that you were willing to do that. And we just want to thank you by our presence here today. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And while they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for the many for the forgiveness of sins." As we think about our time of offering, you know, if we do have Jesus in our heart, and we do know that he's really the answer to our worries and anxieties, one of the things we should want to do is share that with the people around us, and really around the world. And that's one thing we get to do by giving our offerings, is we get to support missionaries around the world, and we get to keep the church here moving and running so that we can impact people in our community. So I would just encourage everybody to give accordingly to what God's given you. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for everything you've given us. We just especially appreciate the gift of your son, Jesus. And we just ask that you would help us to use these gifts to impact the world and our community for you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Wow, it's fantastic to see you. Thank you for coming out. We know that you could be somewhere else right now, but you chose to be here, and so we're grateful to worship with you. At the same time, we thank God because we know that God was also involved in drawing you here, and so we're glad to worship together. A couple things before I get to our message for today. If I can draw your attention in your bulletin, you can read about these later, but tomorrow evening, right here at the church, out in Fellowship Hall, just where we gather out there, we have something that we call Questions and Conversation. On the first Monday night of every month, we just have a time where I'll be there to lead the group, but it's very informal, just come as you are, but it's a time where you can ask any question, and we talk about it. We try to look at what the Bible says about various things, about faith and life in Christ, about the world that we live in, whatever it is that God prompts you. We think it's an opportunity to look where Jesus intersects that and to talk about it together. So that's tomorrow evening. It's open to anyone and everyone. You don't have to be a member of the church or even come to the church here. If you know a friend who has lots of questions about your faith, this would be a great time to bring them and share in that together. So that's tomorrow evening, 7 o'clock here at the church. Also, just mention these two things, and this is really for prayer. Some of you know that what we've really seen happen here at our church is we're looking for ways in which God's at work, and we've seen that with our children's and youth programs where God the only the way that God can do this. He has the majority of the children who come to our CLASH program, which is our midweek Wednesday night for elementary school students, grades 1 through 6. The majority of those students come from families that are not connected to our church or any church that we know of in any real way. And so that's pretty amazing to us, why a family that really has no connection to church would make sure that their kids are able to come to our youth programs. So we treasure that. We really do. One of the things that we felt God's calling us to do as a church is to reach out to those parents and to try to let them know, one, we're grateful to have your children with us, but also we want to try to share the love of Jesus Christ with them. And so last semester, the fall session of CLASH, we had the CLASH kids sing up here during the worship service and invited our parents to come so that we could get a chance to meet them and just to try to grow in some friendships with them. And God brought about 6 or 7 parents that we'd never really seen before, and that was good. We just felt like that's a start. So I'm mentioning all that because CLASH, this session of CLASH here in the spring, ends a week from this coming Wednesday. So it'll be April the 12th. Would you pray with us? Because what we've decided to do this time is we're going to have our elders actually are going to offer a meal for all of the CLASH kids and their families, as well as Fusion kids and their families as well. And so on that evening, the CLASH kids are going to sing for their parents, but then after that, we're going to break them out over into the gym. And our prayer is that we just get a chance to love on the parents who would come to see their kids and get to know them. So pray about that with us, if you would. Pray about April 12th, because we're really hoping to make some connections there. We're not trying to manipulate anything, but we would love to get to know those parents and love on them the way that God has loved on us. So pray about that. The same kind of thing is happening for our Vacation Bible School, which is going to take place in July. But we're looking at having a follow-up event for VBS, because the same kinds of kids, same kind of family dynamics happen there in the fall, to have a follow-up event that would be kind of open to everybody, but a great chance again to try to connect with those parents. So lots of prayer about that will make a difference. So please pray with us about that. And that's some of that's in your bulletin. You'll get a chance to read about that. But we are genuinely excited about what God's going to do there. So pray with us about that. But if you have a Bible, let's turn to Mark chapter 4. Now we'll have the words up on the screen here if you don't have a Bible. If you don't own a Bible, talk to us after the worship service out at the Welcome Center, because we have Bibles that we would love to give you, one to keep as your own. We believe in God's Word that strongly. Just talk to us, we'll get you a Bible. Otherwise, follow in your own Bible or up on the screen here. I'm going to read Mark 4, verses 26 through 34. And just as the background here, I'm picking up in the middle of some teaching that Jesus has been doing. So some of what I mentioned last week, and if you weren't here last week, that's okay. I'm going to refresh us a little bit on that. Jesus is teaching about the kingdom of God, and he's using parables. He's using these word pictures to say, let me give this to you, because if you can understand this word picture, this parable, you'll get a better idea of what I'm talking about, Jesus says, when I mention the phrase kingdom of God. So let's follow along as I read this, Mark chapter 4, 26 through 34. Remember, this is God's word, so listen for God to speak. He also said, "This is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces grain. First the stalk, then the head, then the full kernel in the head. And as soon as the grain is ripe, he puts the sickle to it, because the harvest has come." And again, he said, "What shall I say the kingdom of God is like? Or what parable shall I use to describe it? It's like a mustard seed, which is the smallest of all seeds on earth. And yet when planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants, with such big branches that the birds can perch in its shade." And with many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without using a parable, but when he was alone with his own disciples, he explained everything. Let's take a moment just to pray. Well, Lord, we are grateful that you're here in this place, that your Holy Spirit is present to be able to explain to us what we've just read. And we count on you, Lord, because there's none of us here wise enough to figure it out, but you can reveal yourself. And we pray that happens, not just so that we get some more information about you, but that we are changed by you. So change us, change our lives for your glory, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So here Jesus is again continuing to teach. He's trying to help us understand, hey, this phrase, you're going to see it over and over and over again in the Gospels, kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven. What is Jesus saying? We tried to get a handle on that last week when I said don't think this far distant place like heaven out past the end of the galaxy or something that where I'll go when I die and it'll be great. That's not the primary use in which Jesus is talking. He's not going to deny about heaven, but what he's going to say is the kingdom of God, he said this at the beginning of this book that we're working through, Mark chapter 1, the kingdom of God has come near. That is the presence of God, and not just the presence of God, we said the kingdom of God is Jesus' way of saying that is where God's will is done. So in this world, in this life, what Jesus is revealing is that each one of us, here's our problem. This is the problem that Jesus has come to reveal and then completely solve for us. Our problem is each one of us has our own kingdom. We live our lives pretty much saying, this is my life, my kingdom, I do what I want to do, my will be done. And Jesus says the kingdom of God is one in which it's God's will is done. God, he taught us to pray that way. Your kingdom come, your will be done. So when God, his will is done, that's where the kingdom of God is. And so Jesus brings it very, very close because he says, I can work in you in such a way that you have God's will happening in your life. And not only that, I'll actually change you in such a way that you want God's will. See, because of our own sin, we think my kingdom's the best. But God says, I can change your heart. You'll actually desire God's kingdom, and God's kingdom is for your very best. So Jesus now has gone into this extended teaching in chapter 4 to say, but what's it like to begin to turn your life over so that God's will, his kingdom, comes in your life? What does that look like? And the reason he wants to explain this is because we said in Mark chapter 3, he basically said, look, I chose you as my disciples not because you guys were great. Actually, you guys are at the bottom of the heap. I chose you to show how great my grace is. I chose you because you didn't deserve it. You didn't earn it. And now by choosing you to be my disciples, I'm revealing that, yeah, my grace is for anyone and everyone. But I've come not just to have the kingdom come in you so that you feel better about yourself. Like, hey, I hope Jesus makes my life better. And what we usually mean by that is, I hope I feel better. I hope, like, you know, my life is happy. I hope my life is full of joy and peace and love. And he will do that. Don't get me wrong. But in Mark chapter 3, to his disciples, he says, look, I'm calling you to me so that I can send you out. And he says that in Mark chapter 3, but he still hasn't sent them out. In fact, he won't until we get all the way to Mark chapter 6. So in between, which is where we're at here in Mark 4, why is he waiting to send them out? Well, he's trying to prepare them. He's actually trying to say, look, when I send you out, the mission that you're going to be on is the greatest mission ever. It is the greatest mission purpose that your soul could ever be involved in, which is the rescue mission of all time. That God has said, I don't want even one person to be lost without me. But the way in which I'm going to reach them with this good news that I can change them from their kingdom orientation to mine is through my followers, through you guys. And when I send you out, you're going to spread the good news, but you should be ready. I want to prepare you for this. It won't always go the way that you think it would. When you start to tell people, hey, God really is working in my life from the inside out. Like he's changing my desires. He's changing the way I think. And it actually is resulting in love and joy and peace. But I need to tell you about it. When you do that, he says, and we said, saw this last week, the first parable that he said was like, it's like throwing seed out there. Some people it's going to bounce off of, like a hardened ground that you've been walking over and walking over. The seed hits it, but it never really takes it in. So he's preparing his disciples. Not everybody's going to be thrilled. Not everybody's going to buy into what you're saying about the kingdom of God has come near, that the good news in me is found. And so he says, be ready for that. But here, I think, in our two parables today, I think his primary goal is to bring encouragement. I think what he wants to do is say, I'm going to send you out. Not everybody's going to receive it, but don't be discouraged. How can I help you not be discouraged by sending you out knowing that you're going to get all kinds of responses? Let me give you two more word pictures, he says, two parables. And the first parable that he gives us is one that's fairly common, and it resonates with us here because it's an agricultural community. It's one where he says, okay, imagine another farmer, and this farmer is going to go out and he's going to plant seed, and he plants the seed, and from the time he plants it to the time he harvests, so we're kind of in that time right now, right? In fact, we're all trying to figure out exactly when is harvest going to be this year, and then when you know that, please tell me so that I can make arrangements for when we're going to do that. The farmer basically doesn't do anything to actually cause the seed to grow. So Jesus gives us this picture of a farmer who has a lot of work to do at the beginning where he plants, but then it's a lot of actually waiting until the harvest where a lot of work picks up again. But in between, he says, you're not going to actually be responsible. So here's why I think this is encouragement. Jesus is going to send you out and say, you talk to your fellow students. Talk to your coworkers. Talk to your family members. And when they do, some of them won't receive it, but understand this. Your primary goal is to understand it doesn't actually depend on you. I'm calling you to throw seed, but I'm not calling you to make it grow because you don't have that kind of power in you. This is more what the kingdom of God is like. It doesn't really depend on you. In fact, what this does is it's meant to free us from kind of this overwrought fear that, I have to tell somebody about Jesus, and what if they ask questions I don't know, and I don't know how to answer those questions, and then they're going to be lost forever, and what if I don't say it right, and I'm going to steer them away from Jesus. And here, Jesus, just calm down, throw the seed, but when the seed is out there, it's out of your control. There's actually a more important player in this than you, and that is the Holy Spirit, because only the Holy Spirit can actually change a heart. You can't. I can't. Maybe this is one way to think about this. When I was at the University of Texas, we had a student fellowship. It was a Christian student fellowship, and we did a lot of things just with our group, but we also tried to interact with other groups on campus that were not Christian groups necessarily, fraternities and whatnot. And when they would have different activities, we tried to participate in that. So one of the things they did when I was there was they said, we're going to have this tug-of-war competition between all the different student groups on campus, just for fun, you know, and I think we were trying to raise some money maybe for something, but that's what we'll do. We'll have these groups come together. So our student group said, great, fantastic, let's go ahead and we'll sign up for this, and we'll go ahead and participate and get our Christian group. Now, I mean, we were good guys, but we weren't real bulky, you know, for a Christian group. We were kind of lightweights, and we're like, how are we gonna fare in this competition? And of course, there's also the other side of it is like, we want to, and guys were trying to spiritualize this stuff, you know, we're gonna pull them to Jesus, you know, and we're gonna tug on the heartstrings to get them to Jesus. And most of us were going, yeah, but we want to win, right? We want to win this competition, and we're not going to win with the guys we have. One of the guys brought a guy who had never been to our college group ever, but he was a mountain of a man. I mean, he was ripped. And this guy was huge. I didn't know, in fact, I can't remember his name even to this day, but we're like, we got him on our team. And he's going to anchor this tug of war thing. Of course, we're like, you know, is this full of integrity here? I mean, this guy's not even part of our group. It's for Jesus. It's okay, you know? So we got the rock on the end of our rope. Have you ever been a part of a tug of war? there's probably never a better waste of time than to be a part of a tug of war, because not a whole lot happens. At least it doesn't look like it. You get 9-10 people on each line, and they've got this red cord that's hanging on the middle of this tug of war so that you can kind of see who's making more progress, who's pulling farther than the other team. And you start pulling, and I mean, you're pulling for all your might, but you're giving everything. And when I was part of the team, and you just start to get really tired is what you do. Your arms start to cramp up. I mean, the lactic acid buildup is everywhere, and you're just like, oh, you know, I don't know. But there's this fear, you know, if I let up here, that flag is going to start moving. We're going to lose. But I reached a point where I just really couldn't anymore. And so it kind of looked like I was still pulling, but I really wasn't pulling. I kind of let go. And I thought, you know, we'll lose some ground here, but we'll make it back up. And no kidding, the thing didn't move at all, which is kind of depressing, because you think you're doing something here, and you're not really doing too much when you let go. And in fact, it might have moved an inch our way after I let go, and you're like, wow, I thought this was really leaning on me. And then you look back, and there's Rock back there. He's grunting, and it's like, no, actually, I'm pretty sure it's all this guy right back here. It makes me think of this. In fact, there was an anniversary of this not too long ago, March 28th, 1990. I don't know why I know these dates, but Michael Jordan, March 28th, 1990, scored the most points he ever scored in a game, 69 points in a game. And on that game, that I remember they interviewed one of the other Bulls players, Chicago Bulls, who played with him that game. He was actually a reserve player. His name was Stacey King. And they said, Stacey King was played in the game, but he played minimally. He scored like 1 point. And they said, what's it like to be on the court playing with Michael Jordan when he scores 69 points in a game? Must have been tremendous. And Stacey King said, I will always remember this game, this night, as the night that Michael Jordan and I combined for 70 points. That is really the picture Jesus is trying to give here when he says, here's the parable of the kingdom. Go, preach the gospel, tell your friends and your coworkers and all the people around you, the kingdom of God has come near, and you can find this new life in Jesus, but never ever forget, it ultimately does not depend on you. And this is meant to be encouragement. He's trying to say, something weird happens to Christians when we really think it depends on us. See, because when somebody doesn't respond, we want to argue with them, right? We want to get, oh, how can you not respond to Jesus? What is wrong with you? This is the truth. Why don't you want to receive this? And sometimes we can even win the argument and lose a soul because we're more interested about winning. And Jesus says, you're thinking this really depends on you. You can't change a heart that way. Or you get so anxious and so tense around people, they don't even really want to be around you. And you lose the impact of what I'm doing in your life on a day-by-day basis because you get so intense. And that comes from a misguided idea that it really depends on me. And I can't change a human heart. I can stand up here and preach 1,000 sermons. I cannot change one heart out there. But the amazing thing is, it's really amazing because, I mean, I've said this before, I preach some really bad sermons sometimes, but you guys are so nice. You're like, no, it was great. It was really good, Cliff, really. And I know it wasn't, but I come out and I like, nobody got anything. And then somebody will come to me or say something later that week, Cliff, it was just amazing how I heard God speak. I'm like, it was amazing because it couldn't have been through me. No, you said this thing. I'm like, what are you talking about? And it reminds me again, it's the Holy Spirit. In Acts 16, when Paul is going to preach, and he's just broken into a new area where he's going to preach the gospel, and he begins to preach, and the text says it so clearly. It says there's a woman named Lydia who comes to Jesus. He comes to get in relationship with Jesus, but she does because the Lord opened her heart to the message of Paul. See, we give the message, we throw the seed, but like the farmer, once you've planted that seed, all of your working really isn't going to change how that seed's going to grow. I love that we're in an agricultural community. I mean, we moved here. We're not farmers, but after 11 years here with you guys, I start talking like I know what I'm talking about. Yeah, hey, that shatter cane looks pretty bad over there, doesn't it? You know, you start saying this stuff. But I've noticed this one thing is so true about you guys who farm. You plant, we're really grateful for the rain, it's growing, but a lot of this stuff is so out of your control. I've never once seen any of you farmers sitting around between when you plant and when harvest comes going, ooh. And I'm like, hey, what's going on? Hey, no, don't bother him. Why? Because he is willing his plants to grow. Even as he sits there, he's just willing it to happen. Actually, maybe some of you do that, but I know that doesn't work, right? You know it doesn't work. You know it's in the seed. See, the power is not in you, but the Holy Spirit, I don't know how he does it. We laugh about this at staff meetings on Monday mornings because there's one question that we try to ask at staff meetings. Staff meetings, I'm asking the question, where is God at work? And we're looking at your lives and we're praying for you. But when we see something happening, hey, we've noticed that this person hadn't been to worship for like months and suddenly they're here every single week. What's happening there is not something that we can create or form or cause, but we recognize there's a spark. The Holy Spirit somehow is moving in their life. Sometimes it's through painful things. Sometimes it's in really good things. It doesn't matter either way. The Holy Spirit is sparking a heart. And all we say then is, so wherever God's at work, we want to come alongside because that's not work we can do, but we can sure work with God. That's what he's trying to say. Hey, church, be encouraged. It doesn't ultimately depend on you. So go and preach the gospel. Here's another thing that he wants to say. He wants to encourage us in a number of ways, but one of the things that he wants to say here to us is, take the long view. This is the same parable, but now he's saying it doesn't depend on you, and you have to think longer, because when you plant something, you don't plant and say the very next day, oh, it's not working. It's not working. I planted it. I don't see anything. How often do we do that, though? Well, I did tell him. I did try to share my faith, and nothing happened. Yeah, when did you do that? Yesterday. And they haven't really, they're not even missionaries yet. And it's been 24 hours. You know, why is that? And Jesus is saying, so remember this, church, when I send you out, take the long view here and think about relationships. All by itself, the soil produces grain. First the stalk, then the head, then the full kernel in the head. It's very interesting when Jesus labors here, because if you're a farmer, you're like, we get it. We know how grain grows. His readers, his hearers, get it. Yeah, we understand. First there's the stalk, then there's the head. Why is he laboring on this? Because he's trying to say it takes time. Now, don't get me wrong. There are always occasions where God will take you and you won't know somebody. It'll be a total stranger. And for a brief moment, the Holy Spirit will give you an opportunity to talk with them, share some truth about who God is, and God can do a miracle, bang, on the spot. But predominantly, the way the kingdom of God moves in our world is that God says, get to know them. Build friendships. Authentic, real thing. Not just a friendship so I can use you somehow, but a real friendship that's not trying to get an angle on anything other than to say, I know it's through real relationships that the Holy Spirit is actually going to work. So part of the role of the church, when we send you out these doors and it says you're about to enter your mission field, what it says above our doors is to say part of that involves intentionally getting out of my comfort zone and befriending people that God has placed in my path. At work, at home, in your neighborhood, in your schools, wherever it is, intentionally building relationships with an eye to the long view here. There's a great example of this. John Crilly is a guy who wrote a book, The Art of Spiritual Conversations, but he gives this great example. He said he was put in a time and place where he was actually going to be in charge of 5 refugees from a Kenyan camp, a refugee camp, who were coming over to the U.S. And these guys had been running for their lives, basically, a lot of a war-torn area and basically just trying to survive. And they were able to make their way here to the U.S., and John Crilly was going to be kind of their host for a while, and he knew a little bit about their background. He knew they were Muslim. They were coming from a Muslim camp. They were raised Muslims, and John said, of course, I'm a Christian. He said, I'm looking at them as I pick them up from the airport, and I realize just how different I am. I mean, he said, I'm raised in a family of 4 from the suburbs of Chicago. These guys are coming from a war-torn area. I can't even imagine, and they're Muslim, and I'm Christian, and He said, of course, because I have this desire in me by the Spirit to try to share Jesus with them. I thought, well, they're going to be in my car for a while to get from the airport to my home. It's kind of a captive audience, so I could really let loose on some sermons here. I could really start to, hey, you got to be saved. You got to come to Jesus. And he said, and it really did hear the Holy Spirit speak inside his mind and his heart to say, don't. Listen. And so he said the guys got in the car and they're, you know, basically making introductions. And he said, at one point the Holy Spirit, because he's like, I don't really know what to listen for, the Holy Spirit prompted him to ask questions. Ask him questions. Get to know him. Okay, he said. So we started talking and asking, and he could tell that the relationship was changing right away. As soon as he got out of a mode of, I'm going to tell you the way life is and the way that you should be, into, let me get to know you. Especially, he said, when I asked them this question, knowing that they're Muslim, he said, how does a Muslim pray? He said, it was amazing. Because in that moment, the eyes of all five of those guys suddenly came alive. Like, this guy is not just going through the motions because he's been told he's got to show us around and take care of us. He's like asking questions like he cares about us. Why would he ask about how does a Muslim pray? And he said, and they kind of came alive to that. They start to tell him about the five salats, the five times of prayer that a Muslim prays throughout the day, and what that's like. And so he says, I'm listening to all of this, and we're driving. He said, it was interesting. I didn't understand a lot of it or everything, but he said, I was starting to get a feel for at least some of what they believe and what they do. He said, so when we got home to my house, he said, we got out, and we start getting into the house, and I thought, well, I don't know if that did any good, Lord, but there you go. I did what you said. He comes in the house, he said, and then there was this amazing moment where one of the guys turns to him and says, so how does a Christian pray? How does a Christian pray? And he realized in that moment, well, now God's opened up a door. I could have tried to force my way through that door. I could have tried to knock that door down. I could have insisted, you guys better listen to me about the truth of Jesus. But now God has opened up their hearts to actually hear. Why? Because one guy took enough time to say, you're a human being made in the image of God. And I love you and I care about you because God has loved me in this unconditional. And he opens up and he actually builds some relationship. Do you see the power of what happens when we stop saying, well, I just got to spit this out. That's what evangelism must mean. And say, what if I just actually really cared about people enough to get to know them? That the Holy Spirit opens doors for you and suddenly you get to talk about what it's like to pray in Jesus' name. And why do you do that? Who is this Jesus to you? And so relationships are the big thing. Here Jesus is trying to encourage us. He's saying, don't look for the quick fix. Work long and hard in your relationships, but constantly with this picture, God, open up those doors for me, but I want to love this person unconditionally because that's how you love me. Here's the last part. It's the second parable that he gives us today. God makes the most from the smallest. I think here's the point, because in this parable, he's talking about a particular kind of seed, a mustard seed. And Jesus says, so you get this mustard seed, which is so small, this tiny little seed. And he says, you plant a mustard seed, it's the smallest of all seeds, but when it's planted, it grows. And it grows disproportionately to the size of its seed. And you're like, well, what is that trying to say about the kingdom? There's something here that Jesus is saying. Think about it this way. If I gave you an acorn, and I give you, and I say, you got this huge slab of cement. And if you bring those two together, which one wins? A little acorn or a slab of cement? The slab of cement every single time, right? Now if I give you that same acorn and that same slab of cement, but now I plant the acorn next to the slab of cement, and you let that acorn grow into a towering oak tree, which one wins, the cement or what was that little acorn? I know it's the tree because I see your sidewalks that way all the time, right? Right? It's all, wow, this thing cracks cement. It actually breaks it up. There's a power inside this seed that is stronger, but you would not know it when you're looking at the size, because you're like, how could a power as great as a mighty oak be in such a small seed? That's what he's saying about the mustard seed. He's saying it's so small you wouldn't think it would amount to anything. Do you see what he's saying to us to encourage us as followers, as disciples? He's saying, you guys, you minimize your lives so much. You think, I can't talk. I can't speak. I don't have that gift. I can't do this. My life is so small. And Jesus is saying, do you understand that the kingdom works with the smallest and makes it disproportionately big? It's amazing when you stop to consider what God intentionally does with the smallest of things. I don't know, maybe you've heard of Charles Spurgeon, great preacher of the late 19th century, from about 1850 to the end of that century. He preached all over England, London. He impacted thousands and thousands of lives, brought people to Christ, great preacher. He's known in history, right? But the most amazing thing to me is his story of how he became a believer. He was 15 years old in 1850, and he was not really a Christian. His dad was a pastor, but he knew for himself, yeah, I go to church, I do all that stuff, but it's not me. I have not really made a commitment to Christ. I'm doing this for my family. I'm doing it because it's the expectation of the culture. But in 1850, he was in another town, and he was thinking it was going to be Sunday. He was going to try to get back, but there was a snowstorm. He got stuck in this town, and so he thought, well, I'll go to another church in this town. But that church he couldn't get to because the snowstorm was so bad. And so Charles said he ended up going to this little bitty church. He wanted to go to a bigger church, but just this little bitty church had 12 people worshiping in it. 12 people. So he goes in. He's like, you know, you kind of lower your expectations here a little bit probably. And he says, so I sit down and I'm waiting for the preacher. Everybody's waiting for the preacher because the snowstorm's so bad the preacher can't make it. So, like a good church, 12 people. He said an elderly, thin, frail-looking guy who was a shoemaker, not a preacher, he was a shoemaker, got up because it's pretty hard to say you had church if you didn't have somebody get up and give a sermon. So the guy gets up. He hasn't prepared anything, but Charles said it was interesting because he took a verse of Scripture. He said it was Isaiah 45:22, "Look to me and be saved, all you ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other." He said that one verse, he said it was painful because this one verse, this guy beat into the ground. I mean, that's all he had. He gets one verse and he gets up and he says he really took each word. He's like, look, every one of you can look, he said. And then he's kind of going over and over. Everybody has eyes to see, but do you really see? And the guy just pounded this to death. And then he said, you know, look to me. So you're not just looking anyway. And he just kind of labored on and on. He said, it was just painful to watch this guy do this. He said, but the most amazing thing happened. This guy kept pounding on this verse, and suddenly, here's that spark. The Holy Spirit got hold of Charles' heart, and he said, and I heard it. I heard it 100 times that morning, he said, but I heard it for the first time. Look to me to be saved. And he said, God broke my heart open, and on that day, at that message given by a shoemaker, who was probably up there dying himself. Don't get me, I mean, we know when we're really dying up here. Just get me, he understood that, but he's probably saying, what good. At the end of that day, the shoemaker is almost certainly saying, what a disaster. Why did I even get up there to do that? What good did that do? It's a mustard seed. One mustard seed in a life that God uses to impact thousands of lives. Jesus says it looks insignificant. Your life looks insignificant, it looks powerless, it looks defeated, but actually God's plan is advancing all along the way because nothing can really stop it. Back in 2005, maybe you heard this story, there was a guy, his name was Kyle McDonald, I think is what, yeah, Kyle McDonald. He had one red paperclip. Did you hear this? And he said, what I'm going to do is that old kids game called Bigger and Better, I'm actually going to try to trade. No, I'm not going to buy anything. I'm just going to try to trade up each time. Like, I'll offer this one red paperclip to somebody if they give me something else in return, and then I'm going to go ahead and keep trading. He said, my goal is to trade ultimately this one red paperclip for a house. That's pretty bold, pretty ambitious, right? I'm going to trade this one red paper. He did it. Between 2005 and 2006, and by the way, in a lot less trading than I would have thought was necessary, in 14 trades, he was able to trade one red paper clip for a house. That was interesting, some of these trades he made. He traded the red paper clip initially for a fish-shaped pen. He's got this fish-shaped pen. He trades that for a doorknob. He traded the doorknob for a Coleman stove. Somebody got ripped off there, I think. He traded the Coleman stove for an electric generator. He traded the generator for a Budweiser sign and a keg of beer. And he traded that for a snowmobile. And exactly 1 year, 14 trades later, McDonald finally reached his goal because he traded a part in a Hollywood movie for a house. It's a house in Saskatchewan, so there's probably takes some of the luster off of that, but nevertheless, these trades. And all the way, I'm thinking, so all along the way, you're basically taking something lesser and getting something greater for it, right? Do you realize that's what God is doing in your lives? See, because I know it. I know there are some of you who, and maybe physically you're not even able, it kind of breaks your heart because there are things we talk about, and you say, I want to be involved in that clip, but you know, physically, my health-wise, I'm not really able to do that, but I know I can do this, I can pray. And some of you are praying. Some of you are tremendous prayer warriors, and you're thinking, yeah, I prayed again last night, but what good does it do? It's a mustard seed. And never forget that what you traded, maybe you traded a little sleep, maybe you traded a little bit of your time, but God creates something disproportionately huge out of what you've given. Those of you who are looking at your life right now and thinking, it's so small, what good does it do? Those of you who are in clash, who are working with a small group and you're like, oh, gosh, we just try to survive, it seems like. We're just hanging on some nights. It's kind of chaotic. And do they get anything out of it? And I wonder, is it really worth it? I'm telling you, that's a mustard seed. I mean, those of you, stay-at-home moms, and you're like, oh, I don't know. It just feels so lonely sometimes, and I wonder, is this really making a difference in these little ones that God has given us? And you're like, I don't know. Does this make any difference at all? And I'm telling you, it's a mustard seed. And the kingdom of God advances. And those of you who are in your workplace, and you're trying to say to yourself, I feel like I'm swimming upstream because everybody that I work with does not share treasuring Jesus. They're selfish, they're self-centered, they're crude. I don't want to join into those things. I try to build relationships with them. I seem to get laughed off. I seem to get pushed away. And if I try to show integrity, it feels like I get spotlighted. And then people really don't even like me. And does that do any good at all? And Jesus is saying, you have just traded some of your discomfort, some of your getting out of your comfort zone. You've traded some time. You've traded some of your social status. But I have given you something so much greater because you will see this mustard seed that you've planted. And I will cause it to grow. Not you, but I will cause it to grow. And you will see lives touched for eternity by all of those little things that you do. And it just strikes me how badly Jesus is trying to say here, be encouraged, disciples. Be encouraged. You're going to go out there again this week and you will have the devil say to you, it's not going to make any difference. It doesn't matter. It's too small. It's a mustard seed in the kingdom. And Jesus says, that's a big deal. That's a big deal. Don't be discouraged, church. Go and be his disciples. Grow in the kingdom, but share in this sense of casting seeds. It's not wasted. It's not lost. God takes the smallest things. He makes tremendous things out of it. Let's pray. Lord, I pray encouragement right now because I know how easy it is to be discouraged and to think that our lives are too small to make any difference. They would be, but not in your kingdom. Not when we pursue you, Jesus, above all else. And we confess we don't do that as well as we should, and we have failures, but your kingdom is so great to restore us or bring us back again, and then to encourage us to get back out there, build those relationships. I pray encouragement, God, right now for people who have an eye in their mind on someone that they're trying to reach, and it seems like they're further away than ever, but your Spirit's at work. Take these seeds that we cast, God. Use them for your glory. Encourage your church now, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, keep worshiping here. We're going to have an opportunity to close with this closing song, and we're going to have a baptism right after that, and so just hang with us after this song. But if you have any prayer needs, Pastor Dave's going to be out there, so you can pray with him. Otherwise, let's stand, and let's worship our God.
There's no greater love than Jesus. There's no greater love than He gives. There's no greater love that frees us so deep within. There's no greater love than Jesus. There's no greater love than He gives. There's no greater love that frees us so deep within. We praise Your name.
Excited because we have a young disciple who is still changing. Maya Mim has requested baptism. There you are. And we're very excited whenever this happens because for us, baptism is a sign. You ever wonder, boy, God does this stuff from the inside out, so how do you know when you're seeing that stuff happen? And God gives us this great sign of baptism to basically say, look, I want you to know that on the outside you can see a baptism take place, but on the inside, something real is happening in her heart. And so that's a celebration. We love that. And the fact that she's recognized Jesus has commanded this. And so to have a heart, whenever a heart says, I want to do what Jesus told me to do, that's a big deal for us. And so we're very excited to have her here to be baptized. It is a sign for us of salvation. We don't believe that baptism creates salvation. We think Christ's work on the cross does that for us. But it's a powerful sign. It's an important sign. And so for us, the only relevant question is not how tall you are. It's what it really has to, or how old you are. It really comes down to a heart that's able to express faith. And so we have one question always for anyone who gets baptized, which is this one question I'm going to ask you, Maya. Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Wonderful. Hey, that's a confession of faith right there. And based on that, then, it's entirely appropriate that we baptize you. And so I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son Now we just want to pray because we want to ask God to take this moment and make it so real down the line so that no matter how life twists and turns, she'll know she's anchored in this moment that God will never leave her forsake her. So let's pray. God, thank you for Maya, for her faith in you. She's confessed it. She's expressed it here. And now we get to see a sign of your Holy Spirit at work in her life. We pray, God, for her that you would protect her against the evil one, against all spiritual attacks, God, that in the days to come in her life, this baptism would be a firm reminder to her that you are with her, that you will never leave her or forsake her. And God, use her gifts and talents so that she can glorify you in every way. Take the love that you've given her now and just continue to grow that in the days to come. Thank you, Lord, for letting us be a part of this to celebrate this great moment. And so you get all the glory, all the thanks.